Welcome to the Python for HPC session of the San Diego Summer Institute. I am Andrea Zonka. I am a computational cosmologist at SDSC. Let's first review what are the topics that we're going to cover today. First of all, we will quickly go through the architecture of executing JupyterLab on Expanse on a computing node. Then we need to start to think about optimizing our Python code for high performance computing. So the first step is always to optimize the single node performance. So before introducing the complexity of doing distributed computing, we want to make sure that we make the most out of the resources of each of the nodes. So, and I will introduce Namba, which is a just-in-time compiler for Python that, first of all, can compile Python code on the fly. So you just write standard Python functions using NumPy, and they are automatically optimized to machine code speed, like C or Fortran. And on top of that, also supports automatic parallelization so that you can go implement multiple threads so that you're using all the cores in your machine. Then we will switch to Dask. So Dask is a distributed computing framework for Python, which is very flexible, is very high level, and it's very well documented and helps you start from your serial code and make it multi-threaded or allow to, for example, overlap different functions. For example, in the background, you're reading your data while you are doing the computation as well. Then we will introduce Dask Array, which is like NumPy arrays, but can run distributed. And then we will introduce the distributed scheduler. And finally, we will go more in depth to to Dask Array, which is the most useful feature of Dask for scientific computing. And we'll see how we can use it first to turn some computation multi-threaded so that can use on a single node multiple cores. Then we want to see how you can use Dask to process data that are larger than memory. So basically processing chunks of the data at a time so that you can process data way larger than your available memory, and all of that are done automatically. So that's called out of core computing. And finally, we will go full distributed and introduce Dask running on multiple nodes so that we can have in our simple case, we're going to have a couple of workers, but you can have hundreds of workers distributed across your supercomputer that are all coordinating to execute a specific computation. Okay, so let's start from JupyterLab and the Jupyter Notebook. So by now, everybody knows about the notebook. I would like just to point out the one-to-one relationship. So when you are into a JupyterLab session, each tab in JupyterLab has a one-to-one relationship with a kernel, which is the Python process which is executing the computation that's running in the background, and the document in JSON format. Okay, so you have one tab, one kernel, one JSON document. Okay. If you would like to see what can be done with notebooks, you can look at this analysis released by LIGO, where they show how you can reprocess some gravitational waves using Jupyter notebooks. So it's great for outreach. Okay, so let's take a look. When you are running a Jupyter notebook on your laptop, for example, so you have three parts and they are all running locally. So you have your browser that has different tabs. All of those tabs, or you can even have one single browser tab in JupyterLab, and inside JupyterLab you have the JupyterLab tabs. It's the same thing. And then you have the single web application, the actual Jupyter Notebook server, and then you have the kernels, and so there is a one-to-one mapping between browser tabs and kernels. And you can have multiple kernels in multiple languages running at the same time, all on the same machine, okay? Which in this case is your Jupyter Notebook. And communication is done with HTTP, and then there is another package which is handling communication on this side. So this is a web technology, so of course can run remotely. So here we have our laptop, this which is executing just the front end, and then you connect to your Jupyter session, which is running on the computing node of Expanse in our case. And so you have both the web application and the kernels that are running all of them on this computing node. Okay, so let's see how to actually run one of those. So I'm gonna go quickly because you should have already viewed this. So first of all, let's make sure that you have the repository with the material checked out on your home into Expanse. So SSH with your training account on Expanse, make sure you do git clone and the URL of the Summer Institute so that you have all of the material for this session available. And then you can get into the Python underscore HPC folder and launch the Galileo system. This is just a script to launch Galileo so that you're going to have your session. So if you need to pause the video and do these steps, please do. And I'm going to now switch to my terminal myself. Okay, so I'm going to go inside the repository, 2.1a. Okay, I can launch Jupyter Singularity. And this is going to print out the parameters of the job, and then is going to give me the session that I can copy into a browser tab. And I can see that the reverse proxy is working to launch my session in the background and have it proxied properly to my browser. So in the meantime, you can go back here and say, check that our job is starting, sq-uuser. So you see the job has been running for 30 seconds, so it's still setting everything up. And we can wait here for the job to start. Here it is. So we have our JupyterLab session. Now we are going to execute an introduction notebook. So the session should be already inside the Python HPC folder. So you can open intro.ipymb. Okay, and you can, if you're not much familiar with the Jupyter Notebook, you can take a look around. So you see here how nicely we can even render LaTeX equations. We have embedded plots. And so you see that the host name is the computing node, right? So we are not running on the login node. Okay, that's very important. You never want to run on the login node because that's a shared resources. And also, we are running inside the Singularity container, okay? So we have this Singularity container that I created, so which is a standard Ubuntu with number of Python packages wrapped into a Conda environment so that we have everything that we need here without relying on the software installed on Expanse. Okay, now that we have this ready, we are ready to start the next sessions. But before doing that, I would like to introduce you a couple of concepts to make them clearer because we're going to use them later on. okay? And that's the difference between threads and processes, okay? So let's take a look first at the one on the left. So when you run Python, okay, or when you run Python normally, you have your Python process, which is the whole machinery that's running to execute your code. And then your code has a single thread, okay? That means that only one CPU core at the time can execute that, okay? Now we have machines that have a large number of cores, so all of the rest are idle and just one is executing, okay? So of course, for scientific computing, this is not acceptable. And so what we want to do is to implement code that supports multiple threads, okay? So this is a specific thing that you have to implement into your software to being able to make those different threads available for your CPU to execute on, okay? And the nice thing you see here is that everything is shared. So all the data is shared, so you're not copying. So if you have a large array and you want, for example, a piece of your data being executed by thread one, a piece of the data being executed by thread two, and so on, you can do that if you implement it specifically. And we'll see later with Namba that you can do it automatically, and you can have 128 threads working together on a single component, on a single array. And but then there is another way of achieving parallelism with Python, which, in my opinion, especially for scientific computing, is kind of a hack, which is multiprocessing. So the idea is that instead of having one Python process, you spawn multiple Python processes. So you can imagine a copy of the thing on the left multiple times. The problem is that they don't share data. So each process has their own area of memory they can access. So if you have an array which is in your main session, it's going to be copied many times on all the other processes. And each of them is going to execute just on a single thread. Okay, so that's multiprocessing, which is not very efficient and we want to try to avoid. Sometimes it doesn't matter so much because, for example, we are not processing that much data, and it's fine. But what we want to always try to achieve is having the code which is multi-threaded. Okay. There is a problem with this that by default, Python has a global interpreter lock, so there is a sort of a lock inside the Python interpreter that makes one thread execute at a time, okay? So you have to apply but fortunately there are ways to release the lock, okay? For example, when using NumPy, NumPy is releasing the lock, Namba is automatically releasing the lock so that you can really make sure that you're using multiple threads. If you're not careful, you could have your code that supports multiple threads, but the threads only execute one at a time because the first thread acquires the lock and the other ones are idle. And then once the first thread is done, it releases the lock and the second one gets the lock and so on. And so you don't achieve any parallelism, okay? For that reason, there was the idea of using multiple processes, okay? But thanks to Namba, thanks to NumPy, we can, it's quite easy to implement multiple threading with and achieve good performance. Thank you.